I ran 450 miles across 108 hours. And I purposely didn't imagine how far we were going to go. I got asked that question many a times, and I always said it depends on how far the next farthest person goes, because I'm going to go as far as it takes.
Did you count the miles, or did you think about the miles when you were doing it, or did you just think about doing it?
I had like small milestones, so every 100 miles I'd put on a different shirt that I like a tropical shirt or a vegan shirt or something that just brought a smile to people's face. So yeah, I kind of celebrated that way. And then also we ran basically 11 hours on the trail and 13 hours on the road. So every time we rotated, it actually was kind of nice because you had spent 12 hours roughly on one side, and it just gave you motivation to be switching over to another format.
And it probably things like daylight to dark and that sort of thing probably had an effect as well.
Yeah, I mean, in the zenith of the daytime, it was so hot. I mean, it was in the woods. For some reason, it just captured all the humidity, and it was in the 80s feeling-wise. The last day, there was a Filipino runner who literally passed out on the loop from the heat exhaustion, and he's fine. But it had effect on runners. And at nighttime, it never got really super cold, but it just, with your circadian rhythm, like you especially get to like certain hours where I had to just fight for hours to keep myself awake, where I start to fall asleep as I'm running, and I wake myself up.
You would actually fall asleep while you're running.
While I was running, and I'd catch myself and wake myself up.
Like you do, yeah. If you were driving and
like
you've driven too long.
Something like that, yeah. Yeah, and I would start to like sort of dream or somewhat hallucinate a little bit in that fourth night, where I would just start talking about something off topic to the man who I was teaming up with running. And like, Harvey, what are you talking about? Yeah, it didn't make any sense. And I knew it too. Like, I just started filtering what I was saying to him. Just like, I need to say this.
You're where does your brain go when you're doing this though? I mean, are you just, I mean, thoughts, or how do you focus to do this and not worry about how tired you might be?
Yeah, so there are many levels of where the brain goes. So like at the very simplest level, I may visualize like a close family member or friend, you know, like that's a simple one. At a deeper one, I may I make up stuff like just in my mind. I'll imagine that I'm a Mongolian horse, and the Mongolian horses are famous for running all day and all night, so I just put myself in the state of being like, okay, I'm just Mongolian horse, so I'm just gonna keep on running. Yeah, it's interesting. Like, there's a lot of like potential research that could be done probably in these areas.
The imagery that you're using in your head,
yeah,
will help you get along. Where you're imagining you're floating there, you're imagining you're another right. animal that's just fluid and can just do it.
Absolutely.
Those pictures, yeah. I can see how that could help.
Yeah.
Because you begin to go with the flow of what you're imagining.
Right.
And your body seems to just take on those images.
Right.
And it makes you flow.
Yeah.
And run more smoothly.
Yeah. And then, of course, I mean, we're raising money for the Brighton Center. And so I was getting updates as I was doing the loops, and that I was able to absolutely draw, you know, a positive energy and strength, you know, knowing that we're striving to reach $100,000 in donations, and you know, the number of people that can be impacted.
And what did you end up raising for them?
So far we're not done yet. So far we've raised somewhere in a range of like 30, 35,000, but our goal is 100,000. So we're still continuing with that.
And you're also, you're auctioning the shoes off? Is that what I saw?
Yeah. So we have some items from the race. One of my shirts I wore for 300 miles, perhaps it is, or 400 miles, maybe it's 300. And shoes and like a rock from the course and my race number.
You're going to auction those off for the price. You're not keeping those.
No, I'm not keeping that.
What did you keep from the race?
Well, I do have the one coin. It's like it's Biggs. Big is the famous dog that belongs to Laz, and it's just a little iconic piece. It is the most crazy adventure you can imagine in many ways. This man made up, he came up with this idea back when he was in high school, and now he's like nearly 70 years of age. And he just thought, like, he wasn't the most talented runner on the team, the fastest runner, but he had a lot of willpower. So he thought, wouldn't it be fascinating to see what would happen in a race where people ran the exact 4.1 miles every hour, which adds up to 100 miles every day, and how, you know, what could happen with that kind of format. So the race was really wild because there's over 400 of them now across the planet. And back when I did it the first time in 2017, there was only one in Tennessee. So it's exploded.
Yeah, it's fast. People are telling you about watching this feed and watching. I mean, what you've heard from a lot of people I know that were watching this thing stream out live.
It more than I realized. Like, even my students today, I didn't realize they actually went home and watched it live. Or my friend up in Middletown, he said his students were watching it. People I've met, like, even on the way walking here, ran people in OTR, they stopped me and say, hey, I watched this stuff. So, I mean, it's like really amazing to me. And I just hope that people like take some positive inspiration in their own lives to go after what they want to do.
Yeah, and what's it mean to you, your students? You came in here, what was that like?
Oh yeah, that's worth more than any money. Yeah, to have like that type of experience is precious to me.
Yeah, the experience of doing it's one thing, but then kind of afterward it's something.
Yeah, something.
I mean, these students, they seem to really, understand what you were doing, and you know.
Yeah, we have amazing students at SCPA.
Yeah. This is tell me what you teach again. What are your?
So I teach AP government and financial literacy.
And a lot of these students are like performance oriented.
Oh
students,
yeah. So every kid at SCPA has a major. So we have art majors from ballet to creative writing, orchestra. And so it's really a special place because it's a public, I believe it's the only K-12 public art school in the country. And it's amazing. We have such a diverse population. We have students that are so talented in their area of specialization. And it is really an environment that gives kids more individualism.
And if there's a message that you think that you bring to them that will help them, they're going to be an actor, or they're going to be a singer or something like that, what lesson do you think they might take from your experience on the course?
Yeah, I hope it's grit. Like that, you know, I think life, we talk about financial literacy, and life has curveballs, and so it's how we adapt to them. You know, being kind to others, you know, being always attempting to grow as human beings.
And that mental fortitude to go forward when you're getting rejection and your body or your mind tells you ought to quit.
Yes.
Maybe you don't.
Yes, that's 100% it. Yeah, I mean, you may be told 28 times that you're absolutely not what we're looking for, but you just have to keep on going.
Yeah, keep on going.
Keep on going.